of equipment and a lot of people. We needed catering, everything. So it was just everything about it.
From the beginning, it was a very visual story. It was really, really, really challenging to actually achieve that kind of a movie in a form of university. We had one day to do the sunrise shot, and nobody wakes up in that morning. And we're driving like crazy to the location. And it was really frustrating because I couldn't help. And it was a matter of like, you know, getting the right filters and getting the right exposures and getting the right angle. And the sun is coming up and we're losing it. And we don't have another day to do it. And I remember myself standing over there on the side and just looking at them like, you know, in a total shock.
The hardest part about doing this was that they're out where they don't have anything and they don't have a way to get anything there. So basically everything is tents and whatever they would have laying around. They can't have furniture and all that. We had to build an army camp out in the middle of the desert that was dated in 1954. So everything had to be before that time period. We had to get everything out there, find all the stuff, build it up, take it back down, bring it all back. It was a big job.
We had two crane shots, right? That were planned for two different days. So the first day we had two cameras. And this is very funny because I didn't want to take two cameras for this. I felt we had just enough crew to handle one camera properly. So one day I come to Ariel and say, you know what? We're taking one camera. And that's it. Like the day before. And that's a decision. He's like, no, I don't think so. No, Kevin came in and they convinced me to take two cameras. The first day we get to the desert. We break, we take one camera to start shooting a scene, then we take the other camera to start prepping the crane shot.
And then we had to cut for lunch, and then we thought we're going to do this scene of the arrival of Bellamy on the crane.
Okay, everything works perfect, the camera goes in the air, we rehearse the movie.
Mateo was very excited about the crane, he was like playing with it.
It was one of my first gear head operation, you know, and it was so incredible, it was great.
So the camera was ready, everything was ready, we're ready to take.
And suddenly, we run the camera, and the camera runs 11 feet, stops. We're like, you know, power problem, whatever. We take it up again, 11 feet, stops.
The camera doesn't work.
And we had our next screenshot the next day on the dry. So we get to the dry lake, set the camera.
Camel was on the location.
We start shooting, 11 feet, boom, the camera disappears again.
And exactly the same trouble, the same problem happened to the second camera.
And suddenly, I remember seeing everybody's face, like, what are we gonna do? That you start feeling something wrong happen.
At that moment, I just felt that I lost my mind.
And we had all these complex moves and all these things we wanted to do.
Jerry had to go next day to Dublin to do Rains of Fire.
And
then there was like this great moment, the sun came out of the clouds. Mark and Santiago and Ben Campbell and Mateo and Rex, they all were like...
All this, I'm telling you, it's in the middle of a sandstorm.
It was a big chaos moment, like everybody was running around. And
to make the long story short, the fuses blew on the camera.
Took the fuses from one of the camera and put it into another and...
The crane was not grounded.
We grounded the crane with the jumper cables I had in my car and...
It was kind of a miracle. I don't know what happened over there, but
they fixed the camera. They solved the problem with the crane.
Just out of the blue.
And we kept on shooting.
Yes!
Okay, so we did the internal camel shack inside of the soundstage, and we actually brought the camel to the soundstage. I was not experienced enough working with animals before. I was quite expecting from Jerry to, you know, to do all the stunts and all the actions by himself. So he had some shots that he had to stand behind the camel and actually pretend that he is having sex with the camel. He was terrified. He was really, really scared. And I was like, you know, I was a pain in the ass. And I was like, listen, Jerry, you know, we got to do it. Be brave. There's a camel trainer. And he was like, really give me a hard time. The Ariel, you know, I cannot do this. The camel is going to kick me. I'm going to fly. And then who's going to pay it? You know, I'm an expensive actor. So actually, the way we shot it like basically we did a lot of the close-ups and medium shots. He was alone over there. And then all the shots that we actually had Jerry and the camel together, we did a very wide shot and we kept it very quiet. So even if there is dialogue in the movie itself while he's screaming on the camel, we had to record it.
Yeah, Jerry.
You did a great job. In the cast, we have also Peter Franzén.
We are surrounded by the great Sahara. The closest town is nearly 550 kilometers. Whoever controls this camp controls the area. I have 440 men, well trained, well armed, ready to fight.
Actually, the surprise and the blessing of this movie was Ori Pfeffer.
No, la la, sir. This is not a cigar. Captain, trust me. I'm very, very relaxed. Please.
Beside them, we had Clifford David.
You know, at a certain point in life, you do things. And ultimately, even though it's funny, you regret having done it.
A pompous.
I've been spending a lot of time with my new friend
Rachel.
Now we have Mexican mafia, Israeli mafia, we have Americans, we have British people, we have Scottish people, we have Finnish, we have French, Spanish. We were a lot of different people from different places. And
they made Jules of the Sahara their life for like 4 days.
Hey, let's go.